thank you for coming. And I know you have a busy week, so thanks for making your 1 hour slot today. So basically, we are going to be dealing with the probability, and the course which I am going to be mirroring is the one at MIT, the OCW Scholar 1, Probabilistic System and Analysis. So, yeah, so the way it generally worked at MIT was that they had 2 lectures a week and they had 2 recitations per week, in which after the lecture, another teaching assistant used to come and teach the problems, and he used to practice the materials which the professor taught in the class. But since we are in the middle of the fall and we are only meeting once a week, so essentially the original course had a 25 lecture sequence, but we might be able to do only the first 12. But I feel that by the time we are able to do that, then you will be mature enough to look at the remaining stuff on your own. And the reason it's important is because when you go into the AI or other things, at that point the inference problems become pretty complicated and you need to have a sense of fundamentals to get a hang about that. So basically that's what I meant by compressed into one. And so before I start, I will just like to mention that probabilities is a curious subject, and it's different from the other mathematics subjects, because here if I am saying something and if I am solving a problem on the board, and you will see it, listen to it, and you will feel that it's fine. But when you go and try to do it on your own, you will find that you don't really understand it. So to get the sense of the things, what's important is that after the lecture, whenever you get the time, you are solving the problems. So there will be some problem sets which I am gonna share, and you do it on your own time, and they also have the solutions on the OCW Scholar website. So I will mark the good questions which I have seen. But when you start initially, the things are gonna become pretty easy, they are gonna look very logical, but then when we go forward, then when we go into more complications, at that point you need to have the practice into the mind. So basically you need to, and the another thing is that you need to write on the paper. So don't write on tablet or a normal Kindle thing or a Remarkable thing, because what you need to feel is actually the friction when you are solving the problems. And you will understand that when you are trying to do it, because that's the way to do math. And the other things, you can just look at the PowerPoints and mug it up one day before the class, but not this subject. So like, I'm taking this course this semester, and luckily enough, I drive the class highest percentage, but the other people were below the mean. So the mean was around 14 and mine was around 28 out of 30. And most of the people will land between 7 to 14. So that's the reason that they don't practice and they mug it up one day before the exam. So I will urge you to just go and do that thing when I am teaching. So the way it will work is that, suppose there are 100 of you. So out of 100, 50 people won't understand what I'm teaching in the class, and they will say that I'm a pretty crappy person. So the rest 50 will understand what I am teaching in the class, but out of those 50, only 25 people will go and read the book, and they will understand that they are actually understanding the concept, and the other 25 will try to read the book, but they still won't understand it, and they will still say that I'm crappy. So basically the people who are crappy are the 50 and 25 guys, which is 50 and 25, and out of 100 guys, it's like 75 people will think that I'm crappy, which comes out to be a 3/4. So basically, out of a class of 100, around 75 people will think that I'm not a good teacher, but that's fine, because that's how the subject functions. And one other thing which I want you to notice is that, so here, like in the first stage, people were just looking, were listening to me, and in the second stage they were reading the books. So this entire thing had a sequential nature to it, and then I was just counting the number of people who thought I was crappy, and I was dividing it by 100, which was the total people here, and we got some fraction, like what is the fraction of people who thought that I'm crappy. So there is that. And the slides which I generally do, so they have sufficient space to write here, and I will try to upload it to the core group, which Stephen was so kind to share with me after the slides. And the content is being mirrored, so it's generally taught by John Sigrist at MIT, and he's a pretty smart guy, but so this is the first time I'm teaching the material. So then in the end, I'm gonna share some of my own understandings and whatever I learned in the field. So you take that with a bit of salt, because that is not written in any book. That's what has come to me while working. So I'll just share those insights with you. So yeah, so basically, to motivate the material, like one of the reasons why you want to study probability is that in anything in the nature, like there are certain uncertain things which you don't know about. So for example, let's say that you are going to a casino and the girl there is doing is giving you a card, and you want to know which card will come next, and you. So it can be any of the random things, and you don't really know it, but if you have studied this subject, then you will know how to count it properly, and in fact you can do that in your brain, and then the big fatty guys will come and throw you out for counting the cards. But that's the thing, that in uncertain situations sometimes you want to get a hang on what are the things and how probable they are. So that's where these concepts are used. So like that was in the real world, but sometimes when you are talking about the engineering applications, for example, you have a network port. So in that network port, you have a lot of packets coming in and a lot of packets coming out. So then the network port, if you look at a router switch, it has a 4-port thing, and all the ports have the inputs in them, and some outputs are going through the wire. So you basically want to understand that in that wire, like whatever input is coming, what fraction of the input is coming out, and whether it makes sense or not. So there are some complicated situations like that where probabilities make sense. Another example which I would like to give is that, imagine that you are in World War II and the Germans are dropping the bombs on you and you are in a bunker. So basically you don't have anything like radar, because it was 1914 in World War II, and if a airplane comes in front of you, on top of you, then it's gonna make a noise and you're gonna look up and say, yeah, that airplane is coming, and it will drop a bomb on you, and you have to basically run before the airplane comes on that. So let's say that out of 100 times, like whenever the airplane comes, you have to raise your eyes up. So then maybe out of 100 times the airplane is actually coming, and so it's gonna become tedious for you to every time look up. So and you are also gonna miss the cases that sometime the aeroplane actually came up and you were not able to see it, and then you are done, right? So you want to build a system which can basically look at the aeroplanes in a far better way than which you can look at, and it should be able to do it at a better chance than what you can. So like out of 10 times, suppose the aeroplane came and you only detected it 2 times because you are a human, you want a radar to basically detect it at 8 out of 10 times instead of 2, right? So that's the purpose, that you want to build a model which takes as input the uncertainties, and you want to do better than what a human was doing. Like you were doing it 2 out of 10 chances, but now you want to do better through a radar. So that's all the deal with the models, that you have a problem, you take an input, and then you try to calculate whether that input has actually changed the probabilities or not. So like earlier you were just seeing the aeroplane 2 out of 10 chances, but you built a radar and you found that it's working 8 out of 10 times. So it's better than a human, right? So that means the model which you developed and the radar which simulated that is pretty good. So that's the inference. And generally, so how the probabilistic models work is that you need to have two notions for the probabilities to function. Yeah, just a moment. Yeah. Okay, so what the probabilistic model means is that generally whenever you are performing any experiment in the world, like you're tossing a die or you're throwing a coin, certain things might occur, right? So whatever things might occur, that is what is known as a sample space. So I'm going to talk about sample space, and then I'm going to talk about how the how each of the things in that things is assigned a number, and what that number is called is a probability law. And then I'm going to talk about how those things follow certain rules on which you think are like axioms. The axioms are the stuff which mathematicians guys say are true, and they are not false. Like they are assumed to be true, and based on those assumptions we build the entire theory of probability. And then we are going to end with some simple examples which I'm going to solve. So like the first thing here is the sample space. So let's, it's not visible.
Yeah, it's good now.
Okay. Yeah. So the sample space here, what you need to understand is that, let's suppose that you had a coin and you were tossing that coin. So that coin has a heads or a tails, right? So basically, what is the possible thing which that coin toss can do? It can have a head or a tails, right? So if I draw this rectangle, it shows that this is the set of entire universe, and it has two possible things. One is that the coin toss might result in a head, and another is that the coin toss might result in a tail, right? So like in this situation, so this entire guy, which is enclosing the two possible things which a coin toss might have resulted in, is known as a sample space, right? And there are two properties to that. The first thing is that you don't have a case in which like you toss the coin and magically it's just rolling and it never falls under the gravity. So it's not like that it's head or tail and something in between, right? It will fall, it will either result in a head or in a tail. So either it will result in a head or a tail. Like if it's already showing head on the top, it won't be showing tail, right? So like if one of the things, if the coin is showing heads on the top, then it's not gonna show tail. And if it's gonna show tail on the top, it's not gonna show head, right? So like either this will occur or this will occur. Both of them can't occur together. So that is one thing which the sample space things must satisfy, that the two out, like the two possible things which you can get from a toss of a coin can't occur together. They can only occur one at a time. And another thing is collectively exhaustive. So the first thing, like if this occurred, this doesn't occur, means the mutual exclusivity principle. And the other one is collectively exhaustive. So what it means is that, so I ask you that if I toss a coin, what can I get? So you can only get heads or tails, you can't get anything else. So you can only get two things. So these two things are present here already. So collectively exhaustive means that the sample space should describe all the possible things which your coin toss can do, right? So here you can only have two possible things, so that's why the two clauses are present here. And another thing is, which people are generally not doing, is to define the sample space at a right granularity. So what do I mean by that? So imagine that I asked you that it's raining in Florida and you are standing in this room today and you're tossing a coin. So what's the chance that you get a heads? So obviously the rain won't have anything to do with tossing the coin, right? If you're standing in a room. So like you could have created a magical sample space by saying that it was showing heads and it's actually raining, and it was showing heads and it's not raining, it was showing tails and it's raining, and it was showing tails and it's not raining, right? You could have constructed this sample space in which the coin toss and the rain you thought were linked together, and you had a spurious belief that the rain had something to affect the coin, and that belief impacted by basically exploding this two-dimensional sample space into a four-dimensional space, where each of the points denotes the combination of whether you got a head or a tail, or whether it rained or not, right? But the point which I'm trying to say is that it's okay, you could solve this problem with that, but the problem is that you know that the tail, that like what you get on the top of the coin and whether it's raining or not, they are pretty independent. They don't depend on each other. So you don't want a sample space like this. You want it to be only these two guys. So try to keep the sample space as simple as possible and try not to make it much difficult. So, like, for analyzing the coin toss problem, you really don't need to analyze whether it's raining or not, since I told you that the people are already enclosed in the room. You could have had that sample space if you were maybe tossing the coin out in the rain, but not for tossing it inside the room. So, yeah. So now I'm gonna basically set up some notation here. So what we are talking about is now coins or dice. So generally in probabilities, we are gonna be talking about coins and the dice. And these are the two fundamental things. And you will see that when we talk about the AI system, it reduces to these two cases only. So imagine that you had a dice in your hand. It had a number from 1 to 6 and you were rolling it. So first time you rolled it, you got a number between 1 and 6. Then you picked up the dice again and you rolled it again. So basically what you are going to do is that, and also imagine that your dice had only 4 faces. Like, it is not a complicated dice, it's a 4-face dice. It does not have 6 faces. So you are going to start and you are going to roll it once. So you are either gonna get 1, 2, 3, or 4, right? And then whatever number you get, let's say that you get a 2. So where did my pen run? Okay, yeah. So let's say that you got a 2, then here you could have also gotten, so then you picked up the number, noted it down, but you're still left with 1 roll. So you again rolled it, and from 2 you could also have gotten a 2, and the second number you have gotten as 1. The third, so once you got 2, you could also have gotten the 2 in the second roll, and you could also have gotten a 3 in the second roll, right? So so basically this branch, like these branches are denoting the first stage, right? When you were only performing the roll once, and once you came on this branch, then you started from that and you partitioned yourself to the 4 things. And you could either have ended up on this 2-2, or you could have ended up on a 2-3, right? So basically what I'm trying to say is that when you are rolling a die twice, the experiment is one. There is only one experiment that I'm rolling a dice twice. But there are 2 stages, where the first stage is yielding you 1 out of the 4 outcomes. And then let's say that you get a 2, then the another stage is when you are rolling it again, and then this tree is branching off again, and you can see that it's again giving you 4 outcomes, right? So there is that. And once you finish all the stages, like you got a 1 here and you got a 1 here, then you have this reading called 1-1, right? So if I'm taking a dice and I'm tossing it twice and I am noting the number which I'm seeing on the top every time, so it will only be 2 numbers, right? So like the first roll can give me 4 numbers because it's a 4-headed die, and the second roll can give me another 4 numbers. So total, like 4 into 4, I can get 16 combinations of numbers. So those combinations are what the leaves of this tree are denoting, right? So just to correct the notation, because generally people don't have the notation correct, this entire thing was one experiment and you were rolling the die once, which was first stage, you were rolling that die another time, which was second stage. And so it was one experiment, but you had 2 stages of that experiment. And when you looked at the leaf of this graph, you were able to find an outcome, which was like this pair of integers, 1 and 3, 1 and 4. And if you trace the path along this graph, like if you got a 2 and then you got a 3, so the path along this graph basically gives you the path which the stages which you followed to achieve that outcome. And the number of leads for this graph are gonna be 16, because there are 16 such outcomes. So this is one way to analyze the sequential experiments, and that's one of the ways where I denoted this. Like, I was scrappy because people didn't like me, and some other people liked me, and so this person was, then he stopped at the first stage, but this one continued on to the second stage where he read a book. So in fact, this is the example of a case where like one of the experiment became constrained, but the other one expanded to the second stage. So here imagine that maybe you rolled a 1 and forgot the leaf, but you started and you rolled the second stage. So it's like a complicated case, but it's still a sequential experiment in nature. So another way to analyze this is, So this is the way to analyze a sequential experiment. But when you analyze it probabilistically, the another way is that, so you take the, so you basically plot a 2D grid and you say that on the first roll, what's the number you got? So you can get 1, 2, 3, or 4. And then on the second roll, what's another number you got? So you got a Y, which is the second roll. So basically, on first roll, if you get 1, in the second roll, you could get any of the numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, which calls for this column, right? Similarly, when you have the second roll, the first roll yielding a 2, then again the second roll can give you any of the values. So these columns are stacked across what you're getting in the first stage. So like this one is, you got this one in the first roll, and in the second roll you're getting 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So there are 16 such outcomes, and this is a square in which this is denoting the first stage. The first stage is corresponding to this region, and this is denoting the second stage, which is corresponding to this region, right? And I'm looking at, okay, I rolled a die once and I got a 1, and I rolled it again, I got a 1. So what's the probability of this? The probability is like, I had total 16 outcomes, right? And in this, there was only one outcome which I got, right? So here it is like the total number of outcomes which I could have gotten were the leaves of this tree, which is 16, and which is equivalent to like 4 rows and 4 columns, which is 16, and this all are equally likely, which is equivalent to the definition of the sample space which I told you. And since they are all equally likely, therefore this all are equally likely, so this guy has to be 1 over 16, okay? In case you don't understand it, yeah, I'll explain that in more detail, yeah. But the only thing to take away from here is that the experiments have a discrete nature, have a sequential nature of the things, and the definitions of experiment outcomes and the stages. So now I'm gonna complicate the problem a little bit more. So this time imagine that you have this square, and this square is basically spread out, like its length is 1, its height is 1, and I'm asking you to throw a dart on that. So I'm asking you that what's the probability that you can hit on a particular point in this, like what's the probability that you can hit on this corner. So like this square has infinite number of points on it, right? So the probability to hit on a particular point here is 0. You can never hit a particular point because you don't know what a point is. Because when you study the geometry says that a point has no area, and infinite points form a line, and the line's length is defined, but not the length of a single point. So the probability of hitting a single point here through a dart is not good, right? But if I were to go and ask you that what's the probability that you hit this particular shaded area in this graph, then you could have told me that yes, I could hit this area by, what's the chance that I could hit this area is that this area divided by the total area of the square. So basically what I mean to say is that when you have a continuous space is that you have the square, and in this the x and y can take any value between 0 and 1 up to any floating point decision, then the probability to hit a single point becomes 0. Because of the Euclidean constraints. But when you take the collection of those points as an area, then you can hit that area and it becomes legible. So probabilities in case of continuous things make sense when we talk about areas, and when we were rolling a dice, then we had something like it can only take 1, 2, 3, it can't take 1.5. So that time it was a discrete thing. So at that time, individual probability that a dice can be rolled as 1 was defined. But here, that you hit the exact point 1-1 is not defined because it has infinite number of values. So yeah. So is this thing clear, or is there any doubt?
Pretty clear.
Okay.
So is it not defined because it's so close to being 0, or you just wouldn't?
It's
know?
Exactly 0.
Exactly.
Because if I told that it's It's so if I told that it's pretty close to zero, then I will say even if it is 0.001,
yeah,
then 0.001 multiplied by infinite points is gonna explode, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it has to be exactly zero. Exactly zero. It cannot be even slightly thin, because otherwise the entire mathematics will explode. I am not sure, I'm not saying that it's correct. I'm just saying that's one subtle fact which mathematicians have assumed, which the calculus is having as a limitation, which you could say. But
mm-hmm.
if you're more interested, there is a post in major theory which you could explain. So let's forget about this mathematics for now, and let's just talk about it in terms of the stuff which I wrote earlier. So can you see if I write here?
Yeah.
So let me just switch on the light. How to switch on the light? Oh.
Maybe try clicking the home button and then going from there, maybe. There you go.
There we go.
Okay. So, you remember the example, right? When I was rolling a coin and I had only a head or a tail, right? So, if I roll it a single time, then I can only get a head. Like, I can get a head or a tail, right? So, what's the chance that I get a head? It's half, right? I can either get a head or a tail, so it's half, right? So basically, I'm getting something. That's what I'm trying to say. That there is nothing called you don't get it, right? You either get a head or you get a tail. So, what's the chance that you get a heads or a tails when you toss a coin? That has to be positive, right? I'm not saying it's half, I'm saying it has to be positive, right? So that's what the first thing is saying, that whenever you are making a sample space, which in your case was rolling a coin, then you define two dots in it which corresponds to whether you roll a high head or tail, and the chance of getting either of those, chance of getting a head or a tail, like whether you get a head or whether you get a tail, those both chances have to be positive. They cannot be negative, right? They can be pretty much exactly zero, because let's say that I rig up a coin so that it has heads on both the sides and I'm just tossing it blindly, it will never return tails. So in that case, the one of the thing will be zero, but the thing to take away from here is that it can never be negative, right? Because you will get something. If you don't get something, then you won't keep it in the sample space. The other thing is that they have to sum up to one. So that's one of the constraints which mathematicians have introduced. So the constraints is this, that so when you're getting a head, that chance, and when you're getting a tail, that chance, both of these chances have to be summing up to one. Okay, so like when I toss a coin, I can have it so basically that probability, I can say that maybe it's half, and here I can say it's half. So these two probabilities have to sum up to one. So like whatever happens in your sample space, if you look at the chances, it has to sum up to one. The other thing is the additivity. So the additivity guy is pretty simple. So let's imagine that you had a sample space where I had a dice. So if I had a dice, so then I make a single roll. What does my sample space look like? If the dice has six faces, it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So I can get a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, and I ask you that, what is the chance that you get a number which is less than or equal to 3? So you would say to me that, okay, I could have gotten a 1, I could have gotten a 2, I could have gotten a 3, right? So you could have drawn a circle around these 3 points, and you would have counted that, okay, what is the chance that I got a 1? What's the chance that I got a 1 is a 1/6, and what's the chance that I got a 2? It's again 1/6, and what's the chance I got a 3? It's again 1/6. So which is basically 3/6, right? So basically what happened is that you had this sample space in which if 1 occurred, 2 couldn't occur, but I ask you that what's the chance that you got a number less than 3? So then you draw a circle around all the possible points which could have yielded you less than 3, and you are just summing up their individual chances. So that's what this guy is saying, that A intersection B is 5. So basically here, if you have 1 and 2. So if 1 occurs, then 2 doesn't occur, right? And then 3 doesn't occur, right? So probability of getting the number less than 3 has to be the sum of individual probabilities, because you are just adding them, and since this occurs, this doesn't occur, so they don't have any overlap between them, right? So that's what is termed as the additivity axiom. So basically what will happen, Stephen, do we have another marker?
Some
right
here. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Ryan.
So, yeah, is this thing clear, like what does, so you can imagine that what this means is that suppose you have this 3, 6 points, 6 faces, like a dice, single roll, so it can yield you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you have a cream cheese with you, and that cream cheese area is 1. So you are spreading that area over this entire region, and since that region only has 6 regions, so that area, that cream cheese has to distribute itself over individual points. So it's like 1, and it has to be partitioned into 6 things. So like each of the point will have 1/6 of the cream cheese going to it. So that's the thing, like the cream cheese area has to be 1, and that cream cheese has to distribute over all the possible things which can happen in the roll of the die. And we assumed that each of the things can occur with equally likely. That's why equal pounds of cheese have to go to equal events, to equal heads. So that's why 1 got divided into 6 parts, and it yielded that the cream cheese assigned to the first guy was 1/6, right? And then I asked you that what's the event, that what's the chance that your cream cheese got assigned to things less than 3. So you just added the cream cheese on top of them, because because the cream cheese went here and cream cheese went here, there was no cream cheese which went to both of them, right? So you could have just added the individual cream cheeses and you were pretty good to go. So there is that. And one other thing which I would like to show you is, let's make the problem a bit more difficult. Let's suppose now we are discussing. So let's say that you were rolling your die. So you got these 6 paired numbers, and you got a 1 and 2, and you got a 2 and 3, right? So let's say that I asked you that what's the chance that you get a number less than or equal to 2. You would say to me, it's these 2 regions, right? The chance to get a number less than or equal to 2. And I ask you, what's the chance to get a number less than or equal to? So I ask you, what's the chance that you got a number which was exactly between 2 and less than 3? So like, what was the chance you got a number which was between 2 and 4? So you would say that the dice could have rolled 2, 3 and 4. So it could have been this dotted guy, right? Which is, so this region is 4, right? So here, if I ask you, what's the chance that these 2 occur together? So you would say, you can see pretty clearly that there are only 4 crosses here, and the cream cheese is distributed over 4 of these regions. It's distributed over the entire thing, but it's gone to here, like 1/6 of all, and it has 4 of these, so it's like 1/6 assigned to all 4. And it has to be 4/6, right? But see the problem. Like, if I take only the first circle, what's the cream cheese which went to it? It's 1/6 + 1/6, which is 2/6, right? And if I take the second circle, what's the cream cheese which went to it? It's 1/6 + 1/6 + 1/6, which is 3/6. So 3/6 for this, 2/6 for this. If I sum them up, it's 5/6, right? But when we are looking at this entire circle, at a broader level, we can see it's 4/6, right? So it means the mathematics is not adding up. So why? The reason is because we counted this cross twice, right? So that's why, how do we get away with that? It's that basically we don't have to count it twice. So how can you do that? So I hope you guys understood the problem. So if I have an event A, so if I have a circle called A and if I have a circle called B, and if I define this region as 1, this region as 2, and with this region as 3. So this region is 2, this region is 1, and this region is 3. So then when I'm looking at the cream cheese over A and B together, I'm basically counting the area 1 plus 2 plus 3, right? And when I'm looking at A, when I'm looking at the area of A, it's basically 1 plus 2, right? So the area of A here, the area of A which you can see is 1 plus 2, and the area of B here is this small guy, 2 plus 3, right? You are only looking at these two events because they were defined. So in the earlier example, where did I draw that? Okay. Yeah. So the area B you were looking at is 2 plus 3. So basically what you need is 1 plus 2 plus 3. How can you get that? So what you can do is you can add these, so you get 1 plus twice of area of 2 plus 3, right? But you need only 1 of area of 2 to get this answer, so you need to subtract 1 of area of 2, right? So basically if I call this as A, then this is known as A intersection B, and this entire event is known as B. So this 1, so this 1, so basically what I'm trying to say is that if you take these two areas, 1 and 3, and let me go up. Yeah. So suppose you had this and you had these two events and you had this region as 1, 2 and 3. So the area of, so if this is A and this is B, then area of A is defined as 1 plus 2, right? And if you are defining the area of B as 2 plus 3, what you need actually is 1 plus 2 plus 3, right? But if you add these two guys, you are getting 1 plus twice of area of 2 plus 3. So you need to subtract the area of 2 from this. So the additional subtraction term can be like subtract the area of 2. So this area of 2 is known as the intersection of two events. So that's the thing that when we're looking, so you need to subtract the intersection area once from this. It's okay if that isn't clear. We will talk about it right now. So this is like one of the small questions which you can see. So here what we have is that same experiment which we had performed, in which we had a tetrahedral die. The first roll yielded 4 outcomes, and then you rolled the die again and it gave you the 4 possible numbers, and so there were 16 possible numbers which you could have had. And each of the numbers were equally likely, so that's why each of the events had a probability of 1 over 16, right? So if I ask the question that what's the probability that I'm getting 1-1 and 1-2, so 1-1 corresponds to I get 1 in the first outcome and I get a 1 in the second outcome, it corresponds to this region, and I get a 1,2, so I get the 1 in the first roll and I get a 2 in the second roll, it corresponds to this region, right? So basically 1-1 is this cross and 1-2 is this cross, so each of these are 1 by 16 in probability, so you could have added the probabilities together, so it could have yielded you 2 over 16, right? And then I ask you one other thing, like what's the probability that x is 1? So if you roll the die first time, you get 1, right? And so you need the x to be 1, and it doesn't matter to you what is the second roll, right? Because you just roll and you're just looking at the first stage. So x is 1 here on all of these 4 points, right? So what this thing is essentially telling you is that you rolled a die first, you got a 1. It's asking you what's the probability that you rolled a 1, right? So basically it doesn't matter whether you rolled anything or not in the second roll, because like the first roll and all, whatever you got in the second state, that doesn't matter because you essentially rolled the one first time, right? So all these crosses are the ones which are satisfying this, right? So individual crosses are there and in all of these classes, x is 1, right? Because here you can see x is 2, 3, and 4. It's not 1 here, so it's 4 in all this. So there are 4 points, and each of these have 1 over 16 probability. So you have basically 1 over 16 plus 1 over 16 plus 1 over 16 plus 1 over 16, which is giving you 4 over 16, right? So there's that. Okay, then the other question is, what's the probability that x plus y is odd? So you are basically talking about rolling the die twice, and you are looking at both the numbers on top, and you are summing them up, and what is the probability that it's odd? So basically, you will look at individual squares of this, and you will check whether that those squares are giving you an odd number or not, and those squares are giving you an odd number or not, and you will just sum those up. So, for example, in this situation, 1 plus, so if I talk about this square is gonna yield 1 plus 1, 2, which is not an odd, right? But if I talk this, here x is 2 and y is 1, so 2 plus 1 is 3, so this is gonna yield me an odd number. And if I talk about 3 plus 1, it's again even, right? It's even. 3 plus 1 is 4, right? And 4 plus 1 is 5, so this is odd. So you can see here 1 plus 2 is 3, and 3 plus 2 is 5. So basically you can see that all of such alternate squares are giving me, the green squares are giving me an odd number whenever I'm summing up. Like 4 and 1 are giving me 5 here. So basically there are 8 squares here. So each of those has probability, has a chance of 1 over 16. So which is like 1 over 2, right? Which makes sense, right? Because if you roll a die twice and you roll the die twice and you sum the numbers, either the numbers will be odd or even, right? So the numbers will be odd or even and they have equal chance, which is 1 over 2, right? So you could have solved this question without constructing this complex case, and you could have just said that in my sample space there are only two things, like either the number is odd or even, and you could have gotten a half directly, right? So this is one of those cases where I started with a complex thing and I performed the points and then the probability summed up to 1 over 2. So this ties with what I am trying to tell you in the earlier thing, that we need to define the sample space at a good level. So the last problem I will leave as a homework for you guys. Okay? Yeah. Cool. So then the other thing which we have is the discrete uniform law, which is pretty much nothing. It's what you have already done. So I'll tell you what I'm trying to say for that. So imagine again that you rolled a dice, okay? That dice had a number. Are you able to see this, or you're not able to see this? Okay, I'll draw it here. So imagine that I rolled a die, and that dice had 1 and 6, 1 to 6 numbers which are coming on top. So it has these three things, right? And I told you that each of these numbers are equally likely to occur, right? Each of these numbers are equally likely to occur because either you roll a 1 or 2, like they have equal chances. So let's say that whatever this chance be, I don't know it. I don't know what that chance is. So it's p, small p. But there are 6 such experiments. So all of those probabilities should sum up to 1, because I told you that when the number of crosses are defined, then whatever the sample space, the individual probabilities have to sum up, and you assume that each of them are equally likely. That's why all will have the probabilities as p. So basically what you can do is you can obtain it, you can add the p 6 times and you can equate it to 1 by using the axioms which I talked about earlier, right? That the probabilities of all the crosses in the sample space have to sum up to 1. And it gives you a 6p, which is 1, and it tells you that the probability of a single point is 1 over 6. So please mind that this result is only obtained when I assume that all of these have probability p, right? Which are equally likely. And now, suppose I ask you that what's the probability that the number is less than or equal to 3? So suppose I am writing the numbers on the top, which I am returning, and I'm asking you what's the number what's the probability that the number is less than or equal to 3, right? So what I will say is that probability that number is less than or equal to 3 is basically probability of getting 1 plus probability of getting 2 plus probability of getting 3. Why? Because I told you that if the points are discrete in nature, then once they come inside a circle, you can add their own things up. So you don't know what these probabilities are, and you can calculate, and you assume that these points are equally likely, so that's why each of these guys had a probability 3, right? So if I tell each of these have a probability p, it becomes p plus p plus p, which is 3 over 3p, right? And what's the value of p which we obtain? It's 1 over 6, right? Here. So I can put 3 over 6 here. So what does this formula mean? This formula means that don't do anything, just count, like what are the number of elements which are satisfying this? 3. What is the total number of elements which are present in the sample space? 6. So just put the number of items which are satisfying this, and just put the number of items which are present in the total thing, and you find the answer that what's the chance that your probability is less than 3, right? But why? It was because I could have put, because when I calculated it by the sum, I could have equated all of them as p, because I assumed that they were equally likely. And since I got the p's, and I already knew that the p was 1 over 6, so I was able to get this formula by making two assumptions. One, that each of the event is equally likely, right? And the second one is that they should sum up to 1, right? So like this is the universal norm, which is the truth. But this, that the probabilities have to be equal, that is what I assumed. It need not be the case. So this formula, that you just count whether they are lying in the individual circles and divide it by this, this only holds true when the events in this, when the crosses in the sample space are equally likely, okay? So that's what this entire guy says. It's assuming that all the outcomes are equally likely. So you have this piece, and it can sum those up, and it can derive that formula by just calculating and then just putting up these mathematic things. So this law holds true only for the case of fair coins, fair dice, and cards, where if you have a deck of 52 cards, probability of getting a card out is 1 over 52 because all the cards are identical. So only then this will make sense, but in the most general case, you are just adding their probabilities, right? If the probabilities are different, the different terms will go in the summation, but you can still add them because they are discrete in nature. If they were continuous, they would have been infinite events, and then instead of adding, you would have to integrate. Okay? Yeah. So is there anything which is not clear here? All things are clear. Pretty much. Oh, you guys are pretty smart. It took me pretty long to get my head around this. Okay, cool. So a quick question for you. What's the probability that a point here is 1, or like I hit the exact 1 by 2 and 1 by 2? What's the probability for that?
0.
0, right? Why? Cool. Okay. What's the probability that I hit a point 10, 10? Why?
It's nine.
Right. So, what's the probability that I can hit the sum, like the sum of two points is less than half? So now, the mathematicians are pretty crappy people. They told that whenever the things are infinite, I can't go ahead and add them up like I did in the case of dice. So then they invented the blind concept of integration, which is nothing but just taking the area. And what I told about area is that, again, the same notion applied, that each point is equally likely. So the total event area is 1, should be 1, and the individual event should be the area divided by the total area. So so probability that xy is half, so if I draw this line, x plus y equal to 1 over 2, so at this point, x is 0 and y is half, right? X is half and y is 0, and at this point, x is 0 and y is half, right? And if I look at the region below this guy, that is the entire region over which the sum of two guys should be less than half, right? Because you know that if you draw a line, the value is exactly half. On one side, it is greater than half. So you can check, at this point it's 1, 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. 2 is greater than half. So this entire region is bad. So this entire region is good, but it only this region lies in the square which is given to us. So only this region remains. So the probability of that region has to be this area divided by the total area. But why? Because all the points are assumed to be equally likely. Always remember this fact, because it's gonna change. So what's the area of the triangle with a height of half and a base of half? It's half of base into height, right? Which is 1 over 8. And what's the area of the square? It's 1 into 1, length into breadth. So the overall probability comes out to be half, right? Okay, and what's the probability that the point is exactly 0.5 and 0.3?
Zero.
Zero. Four. Yeah. So it's easy to calculate the area of triangle here because you know the formula for that. But I could make a pretty weird shape, like I could have made a pretty weird shape like this and asked you to calculate the area for that. And no mathematics can do that except integration. But what I'm trying to say to you is that this calculating this area is not the regime of probabilities. The concept is that you just add the probabilities. You just have to find the area. And how to find the area is calculus, which you already know. So there is that. Okay. So there is one thing which is one subtlety which you need to understand, which is this. So I told you that in this situation there are infinite points present on this square, right? On this square, let me just clear this off once. Yeah. So on this square there are infinite points present, and I cannot go and sum up the infinite points. Because let's say, I told the probability of a point is 0, right? And there are infinite points here. So infinite times 0 is still gonna be 0, right? And I am saying instead that the sum of all the probabilities in this region has to be 1. It means I am wrong, right? So the issue is that the notion of adding the, so when I assume that I can add the probabilities of individual points together, at that point I was assuming that the number of points which are given to me are finite in nature. So it's like if I had the dice, I assumed that each, there were only 6 outcomes. So I knew that number 6 beforehand. But here, I don't know the number, it's infinite, right? And I'm doing an infinite into 0, which is a non-defined term. So what the problem, appears to be that when you have the points packed into this area, you can't sum up the individual points probabilities. So you get up, you can't sum it up because it's gonna sum up to 0. So you get away by just saying that the probability is just defined by area, right? So summing the probabilities is for the discrete case when you were talking about the dice. But when you're talking about area, it's only, when you're talking about continuous case, then you're just taking the area. And you're taking the area because you are getting away with the fact that you can't sum up the individual points because they would have summed up to 0. Because the individual points probability is 0, and even if it has infinite points, it would have summed up to 0. So you get away with that fact by defining that the probability inside this weird shape is the area of this curve, right? So you take this area and the total area and you get. So the notion of defining the probability law is different, right? In one case, it's adding the probabilities. In another case, it's defining the area. But what I'm trying to say to you is that this problem arose because the number of points in this are infinite, right? So now I'm gonna say that sometimes it is possible to have infinite points and still their collection will yield a finite probability. So what it means is something like this. So imagine that you were basically taking a coin and you were tossing it first time and you got a heads, okay? So what's the chance that you got a head? In the first toss, you could have gotten a head or tail, and they are equally likely, so you could have gotten it with a chance of 1 over 2, right? But let's say that you didn't get the heads, you got a tails, so then you toss it again, and you get the heads a second time. So basically what I'm trying to say is that you keep on tossing the coin unless you get a head. So like you get the head once, in the first stage if you get the head, you are happy, right? You don't continue it further, which corresponds to pruning this tree. So like this tree had two levels, this had only one level, right? If a person has thought that I am crappy, he won't ever study the book. So when you toss the coin first, you got it with a probability of half, right? Then suppose you didn't get it in the first toss, so you got a tails, and in the second toss you got a heads. So that moment when you're talking about two stages and you are assuming that you get a head in the second toss, at that time the possible outcomes which you have are these, right? Heads, 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 tails, tails, heads, and tails, tails, right? And I'm saying that you are getting a heads in the last toss, right? So basically what probability is this? It is 1 over 4, right? Because you have 4 outcomes here. So so then the probability of getting a heads in the second stage is 1 over 4, assuming that you got a tails in the first stage. And then you would have also continued to 3 tosses if you had not gotten the tails in the heads in first 2, but you got a heads in the third one. So now what I'm trying to say is, if you look here, you can perform infinite trials, right? You can do infinite tosses unless you get a heads. And if I was to ask you that what's the probability of getting a heads ever, so you would have told me that it's the probabilities of these infinite terms summed up, right? And if you see the probabilities, they are like half, 4, 1/4, 1/8, 1/16. So these all probabilities are decreasing, right? In the uniform case, when I was talking about this case, here, when you were talking about this green area, the points were infinite, but the probabilities of all those were zeros, right? But here, the probabilities are decreasing. So if I sum up these probabilities, you will find that they sum up to 1 over 2. Okay, so yes, although you have infinite tosses, you can still have the probabilities sum up to half. So this.
Well, so the coin problem that you described is not the problem that's there. So
yeah, I think you're describing it in terms of even numbers.
Okay, we will come back to this. Let me look at it in more detail. But I think I'm correct.
If you have the coin problem, it should sum to one. But the problem that's there is a different problem that will sum to a different outcome.
Okay, I'll check it out. So. These are some of the questions which you could solve, and I will leave this over the chat. And now let me just close to this stuff with some of my own things, okay? Yeah, so what are the problems with probabilities and why they are creeping into the AI systems? So first thing, when I ask you, okay Stephen, I gave you a dice, I'm telling you never to roll it. What's the probability that you will get a 1?
0, because I'm never going to roll a dice.
Yeah, but what's your belief? Like, what's the probability? Like, maybe Stephen says that the dice is pretty good and it's always going to give you a 6. So in that case, you will say that it's 1, right? The probability of getting a 6 is 1, mm-hmm. And the probability of getting all the other numbers is 0, right? But it has some other, like the total thing, even if you haven't rolled it, has to be 1, right? Because mm-hmm. That's the law. So the point is that what's the probability that I'm going to die tomorrow? Don't know. I can only die only once, right? What's the probability that a coin will give me a heads? So if I roll it infinite times and I observe it, by, I notice a large number, I roll it many times and I calculate the number of times I get the heads, then it will be approximately equal to half, not exactly, because there is no definition of infinity. And I could have rolled the coin, right? Because it was something which I could have rolled, but I can't die many times. I can only die once, right? So I can't solve that experiment for me. I can only solve it for saying that there are people like me and they have died in the past. So based on their trends, this is the probability by which you can die. So this is one problem with the probabilities, that what you're doing is first I ask you what's the probability that the number on your die is 1. So you are assuming that you know that it can only give you 6 outcomes, right? What if I never told you what is the face, like what is the number of faces on the die? So probabilities can't be described when you don't know the outcomes of the experiments ahead of time, and you can't perform the experiments ahead of the time. Like, you can't know all the outcomes in the experiments unless you perform them, and you can't perform all the experiments many times, like the death case. So that is one of the problems with the probabilities. So there is one thing which the mathematician guys do. So where is the rest of?
What is it?
The eraser?
Yeah.
I think there's one over there. On that chair.
Oh, on the chair on your right.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So let's say that I had a dice in my hand and I always believed that it will turn up the 6 because I think that it's not the... He won't know this the pick of my fingers. He will think that there is something wrong with the die, and then he will go and check his manufacturing process. So this is what Stephen believes. And this is what I believe. Right? So I believe that the die will always roll a 6 with probability 1, and it will always roll 0, like with probability 0, it will always roll the rest of the 5 stuffs. And this is our belief even before we are performing the experiment, right? Now let's say that I rolled it once, okay? So from this dot, I'm rolling it once. So I rolled it once, so I got a 6. So in how many outcomes, so how many, like I have made one roll, right? And I got a 6, right? So with probability 1, I have gotten 6, right? And then let's say that I rolled it again and I got a 6 again. So this experiment gets copied. And out of the 2 experiments, I am still getting a 6, right? So it's still 1. So now, Stephen believed that it was 1 by 6 in the starting, and he has to change his belief to this guy, right? What I'm trying to say is that for him to put all the zeros here is pretty difficult. Why? Can anyone tell?
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah. So the question is this, that when I, so this was what Stephen believed, and this was what I believed, okay? And I actually rolled it twice, and I found that 1 is always coming, okay? But, so ideally Stephen's belief should be changed to this, right? But it doesn't, because Stephen will always say, I think that maybe in the future, on more rolls of die, you might not get a 6.
I don't know about your magic fingers.
Yeah. You only rolled it twice because you haven't made an infinite roll. So he will say that, okay, instead of 1-6, I can say that the probability of getting a 6 is now more because you have rolled more 6s, and these are maybe some quantities slightly lesser than 1-6, which is fine, right? But for him to make it exactly zeros, I would have to roll it many times for him to prove to him explicitly that your dice is screwed up, right? You got my point? So for him to change his belief from all 1-6s to zeros, I would have to roll it many times so that he reduces it gradually from 1-6 to 0. He can't do from 1-6 to 0 in a single shot.
If this were a casino, I would kick you out long before you get to that point,
yeah.
Absolutely.
So that's the problem with probabilities, that even if you have something which is a truth, and if you start with equally likely cases, you have to train your networks many times until you can converge to these zeros. So although you could have gotten away through this with a ranking problem, so let's say that I ranked them, okay? I said that the ranks of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are equal. Like, they are equally likely. This is what Stephen believed. And then I rolled it once and 6 came, right? So 6 came more frequently, 6 came twice, other things came 0 times, right? So the rank of 6 is above all this, right? So now the belief of Stephen is pretty good, right? He says that Okay, these never came, so they are 0, and this came, so it's 1. Right? So that's why the rolling system works like this is the ranking system, and he was ranking, but and this was the probability system, and he was rolling it, and he was revising his belief by calculating the number of times the experiment came and then taking the ratios. So this failed, but this is successful. So the AI systems are not implementing ranking right now. They are implementing the posteriors. And I can go deeper into that when we go further. Yeah, so there is that. Cool, I think we are done. And this was something which was called by Marvin Minsky in his book, Society of Mind, so at MIT. He got Turing, so he showed the concept of ranking. So there is that. So in case, yeah, so thanks for coming. I think we are done.